Ireland, the name we've given to this place that we call home. But what's in a name? Scratch beneath the surface and you'll find not only the secrets of the landscape, but also the secrets of the people who walked this land before us and who named it. In this series, I'm following in the footsteps of Ireland's first official place name collectors to create my very own atlas of Ireland's place names. He went to the trouble of documenting beautifully the Irish spelling.
That was so important, and if it wasn't documented, then we would have lost that.
Some are more than just a place name.
There was a time, I suppose, when those names were essential. Your safety often relied on them.
And they arouse fierce passion in us.
Do you know what? We are proud of our place name. It gives us our identity.
But all of them reveal something about who we are and who we used to be. I'm following in the footsteps of John O'Donovan, the man who mapped Ireland's place names back in the 1830s. And today, I'm meeting a modern-day place names officer, Dr. Cruhuro Cruellee.
How are you?
I'm grand now, Cruhuro, and yourself?
Who has written extensively on the place names throughout County Wexford. The Vikings named it Viceffjord, apparently meaning inlet of the mudflats. But what does the Irish name Loch Gorman mean? Place name lore would suggest that its Gaelic name comes from a man called Gorman.
The actual probable meaning of Loch Gorman is not any of the explanations that's given in the mythology. It's actually straightforward. Gorma can mean a point of land, a headland. So it's the lake of the headlands, and at the mouth of Wexford Harbour, there's two headlands. But in early Irish literature, from around the 12th century, there's an alternative name, which is Loch Fuilchon, which means the wolf's lake.
Fuilchon.
Yeah. Fuilchu is an alternative word in Irish for a wolf.
In various forms, the word wolf appears in place names right across the country. For example, cú, meaning hound, can also refer to a wolf. In the plural, it's often given as con, like Nochnagon or Canochnagon, hill of the wolves. Madra or Madda can also refer to a wolf. And so, Glenamaddy, which began as Glown the Madda, can be interpreted as Glen of the Wolves. And then there's my favourite word for wolf, Mac Tíre, literally meaning son of the land, and that's abundant in Wexford.
Because this is Glen Tyre. And I'd say most people don't actually realise that Glen Tyre is from Cluain Mhíre, which means the meadow or the pasture of the wolf. Where I'm going to bring you now is Tuim is the name of the townland, but actually the research shows that it's from Tuim na Mac Tíre, which means the mound of the wolves.
Arriving in Tuim, it's apparent the high ground here has given the townland its name. There is no mound visible anymore, and there's no trace of wolves here, other than in the place name.
Clearly marked on the map. Place name itself is absolutely certain, Tuim na Mac Tíre, the mound of the wolves. We've already seen Glown Mhíre, the pasture of the wolves. And over at Mount Leinster, we have the last reliable record of a wolf in Ireland being killed in 1785.
So wolves are all over the folklore and the place names of this part of Wexford.
All over the place names in County Wexford, and indeed all over the place names in the rest of the country. Yeah.
Nearby Salisbury Wood gives us a very accurate impression of what this countryside looked like back in the time of the Irish wolf. It's where I meet Kieran Hickey of University College Cork, the author of the book Wolves in Ireland.
So at their peak, how many wolves would you say were in Ireland, were howling in woods like this at night?
Maybe around 1,000 wolves in and around AD 1600. So there would have been packs all over Ireland, definitely in every single county and province, and we're talking about 100, 150 possible packs.
Why did they disappear? What happened?
Well, one of the big factors was the Crovellian government when it came into Ireland. They created a bounty system for hunting of wolves. You had actually the activities of a few professional wolf hunters who were brought in. One of the big factors was obviously deforestation. So from 1600 to 1700, Ireland went from roughly 12.5% native forest to maybe 2.5%. And in fact, Ireland was once known by the settlers as Wolfland because there were so many wolves here. And it's also the case that the Cromwellians and the Cromwellian government tried to sell Ireland as a place for settlers to come back over. And they were told there was lots of good quality land available, but there wasn't. It was covered in forest or scrub forest. Yeah. they were told that the natives were friendly, and of course we know the natives certainly weren't friendly.
We are to certain people, yeah.
And they were also told that there was virtually no wolves, and of course there was loads of wolves. So they were actually really sold a real lie here.
Yeah, they sold a pup, literally, I suppose, yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, that was very interesting, although it was tinged with some sadness because the wolf is gone. Even the mound of the wolves has disappeared under farmland. And so many of our great wild animals, like the eagle and the wild boar, have disappeared. The only good thing is they're remembered in our place names. I would like to think that they wouldn't go as well.
The presence of Vikings along the southeast coast of Ireland is well documented. But I'm looking for evidence that they actually settled here in Dungarvan. My first port of call is Helvik Head. It comes from the Old Norse Helgivik, meaning safe bay, spelled Helvik Askuelge. James Yogan, senior archaeologist with Transport Infrastructure Ireland, is a Viking expert who discovered one of Europe's biggest Viking settlements just under the soil at Woodstown, here in County Waterford.
Before the bypass was built, we were doing archaeological investigations and we discovered a huge Viking settlement site, a site that's called a Lungfort. Well, Lungfort is it's an Irish term that's found in the annals, and it means a ship fort or a ship landing.
And you have any record of those around here?
And so here in Dungarvan Bay, there's the place named Killungfort. So maybe that reflects that this was a place where Vikings might have had a Lungfort. Now, we don't have any archaeological evidence,
right,
unfortunately, but bear in mind what we found at Woodstown was a significant and substantial settlement, 450 metres long. The ditch surrounding it was 4 metres wide, up to 2 metres deep.
Yeah.
It was only when the archaeologists started digging trenches to investigate, you know, the possible route of the bypass that we came across this fantastic site.
Just as they did when the Vikings arrived in the 9th century, the natives are watching from the shoreline. But with all these smiling faces out to greet us, I think we'll have to cancel the pillaging and the plundering. I just haven't got the heart for it. Being in Dungarvan gives me a chance to meet up with Chef Paul Flynn of the tannery. I have a bit of a challenge for him.
I'm a Viking in your own town for the day, having a bit of crack.
Okay.
Would you be able to knock together like a seafood menu, like a Viking seafood menu?
Of course I will. I'll do a bit of research.
Yeah. Beach tucker, I think, is what
it is. Beach tucker. And I'll meet you on the beach and I'll feed you. That's not okay?
Brilliant. Looking forward to it. Thanks,
Paul. Best of luck.
All the best.
The name Dungarvan comes from the town's Irish name, which means Garvan's fort, referring to St. Garvan, who founded a church here back in the 7th century. Dungarvan is known primarily as a Norman town, and Christina O'Connor of the Waterford County Museum is involved in the Gallows Hill Community Archaeology Project. They recently solved the mysteries of this mound in Dungarvan, known locally as Gallows Hill.
We're building up a brilliant picture. I mean, what we found is 3 or 4 different layers of history. So we've gone from, I suppose, gallows to a fort, a fairly significant fort in the 1700s, 1600s.
Yeah.
We then possibly have a burials then in between there.
Now they've turned their attention onto Viking Dungarvan. There are plenty of clues that point to the possibility that Dungarvan was Viking before the Normans arrived. We head to the outskirts of town, to the townland of Killungfort.
So this is a photogrammetry aerial image. So what it is, it's an image that combines many aerial photographs put together, and it just shows up features and points that wouldn't be
obvious
a flat with an aerial,
a
normal aerial photograph.
Yeah.
It's just giving you a hint that there's some form of feature here.
So in general terms, like, this whole area here would be a perfect settlement for Vikings to pull in and do a bit of plundering.
I mean, the area would be a perfect Longfort settlement. If you look at the terrain, the landscape, it would certainly fit the idea of what a Longfort could be.
Yeah, it seems you're very close to kind of game, set and match in terms of proving the Vikings lived here, because the place names like Helvig and all the rest of it.
You've got Ballinagowl, you've got the place name Killongfers here, you've got Knockmone, where there was a coin hoard found, then you've got Shandon, the other river, where we've got a settlement, we've got a Norse coin, a Norse trial piece.
Yeah.
Then across from Shandon, you've got a bit of folklore that talks about a Bohr na Norse, so a Norse road. There's a lot of hints and suggestions that the Vikings were here, but it's just about proving it. It's about finding that evidence. You could do a geophysical survey or another community project similar to Gallows Hill.
Yeah. It's the place names I'm after, and they all seem to point to Scandinavia.
Time to catch up with Chef Paul Flynn, who promised me some Viking grub earlier today.
When I looked into this, I have a friend who's an archaeologist, and he was telling me that when they were excavating Waterford City, they came across the foundations of houses from Viking times, and the foundations were laid on thousands and thousands of oyster shells. So I'm going to give you one of these oysters, and, you know, they're just very, very lightly cooked. And they're gorgeous.
Mm. Salty.
And these are lovely Hearty's oysters from the bay.
It's Tucker, isn't it?
Unctuousness.
Yeah.
You're ready now to go out and just move on to whatever country you're going next.
Yeah, I feel like killing someone after this.
Definitely.
I think Killongfert is really the key to all of this. It's the perfect place to land a boat, it's the perfect place to find fresh water, eat your fill of fresh oysters, as I did, and maybe get yourself an old wild boar or two as well for the stew. Yeah. This place is Viking heaven.
I'm meeting historian and folklorist Shane Lahan at his home, the aptly named Tí Bui, or Yellow House, just a few miles from Cork City, for what I'm told will be a long day on foot.
But I feel like I'm lost.
Yeah, 10 miles from Cork City, halfway between Nadd an Uller, the eagle's nest out this way, turning point up here to Berings and up to the most magnificent area beyond us, Má Tathe.
Má Tathe.
Signpost over here, misspelt, I have to say.
Misspelt in English or in Irish?
Certainly in English. Go on, give us a guess. What do you think it is?
Má Tathe. It's fairly straightforward. I'd say Má is a plane, a floodplain, is it? A plane? Tathe. Of the houses? Is it like a cluster of houses on a plane?
Well, it's a very good guess, but I'm afraid the story is way more interesting than that.
Shane's story starts here at an old mass rock, which is still in use. His story is set in the 1600s, when the penal laws were enacted to suppress Catholic Ireland, and priest hunters roamed the land.
This is where the story begins, and I have to tell you this, when I moved into the Yellow House, within a few minutes of the first time I was in here, I heard this story, and I heard it over and over, five or six times in the one day.
Different people.
This is the one story that unites this community in this area. And the story is that there was a famous Captain Fox. He was a priest hunter. His group came along in and around this area, and what happens is that the lookouts didn't see him. He snuck up behind the priest that was celebrating. As the story goes, it was during the adoration of the Eucharist when the priest held it off to the Eucharist. Captain Fox came up, took off the Eucharist and took off the priest's head. An incredible sort of story. And what he did is he impaled the head on a stick and he flew off in this direction here on his horse.
The triumphant Captain Fox made his way across Má Tathe, through Vicarstown Cross, and past the old graveyard, brandishing the macabre trophy for all to see, until he came to this steep section of road which drops down to the Shornoch River. Shane picks up the story.
But this is the hill where Captain Fox met his doom.
He came down this hill?
He came down this hill, going on a gallop. According to the legend, there was a clap of thunder. The horse shied up, off when Captain Fox threw him out over the reins, hit his head, broke his neck, dead. And ever since, you know, this area is still called Fox's Bridge.
Is that the name of that bridge it is?
That's where we are. So what happens is that the yeomen that were there, they were terrified, they didn't know what to do. They had a dead captain, they didn't want to leave him on the road. They searched out the closest graveyard, and that was Loch Awe, just over across the way here. So that's where we'll go next.
Next port of call.
Continue the story.
Great.
So we're off again to another ancient overgrown graveyard in the nearby townland of Loch Awn.
Would you reckon there's actually a cemetery in there?
Well, we'll have to try and get in and have a look. Look, we'll try in here. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you pick a nice nettly spot for me.
Yeah, not too bad. So this is Loch Awn graveyard. It doesn't look like much now, no, John, I have to say. But when you look around here, what would have been here in the past were a whole set of headstones. This was a proper cemetery. It's marked on the ordnance maps, OK? And what happened, of course, is the Captain Fox's men, they buried Captain Fox here.
Sacred ground.
The corpses and the bodies were here. They did not want to be buried with a priest killer. Right. So the legend has it that at midnight, what happened? The ground began to rumble. They came up out of their graves. They took their headstones and their coffins and they headed off across the way. What it should mean is that there are no graves here, except there should be one. Just one headstone.
Fox himself.
Fox himself should be here. You're looking for one single solitary headstone, John.
Any luck, Shane, no?
No, nothing yet.
I found a horseshoe. I have a stone over here.
Really?
Yeah.
Hold on. Well, it looks very like a headstone to me, and there's only one headstone in the whole place.
Do you reckon that would have been it?
Well, it certainly gives us some evidence to say the legend has some authenticity. Yeah.
Heading back across the river and up to Máithtéithe Graveyard, we're literally following in the footsteps of the lost souls who made the same journey on that fateful night.
So, John, to finish our story, here we are in the graveyard of Máithtéithe. And what's amazing is that all the corpses came up carrying their headstones, crept under the soil here. They were all reinterred here. And that's where we get the name of this district. It comes from Máithtéithe, meaning the plain of flight, the plain of fleeing the priest killer. Do you know what? That's what gives our area here its identity. Everyone knows this story. It's a story that everyone in this area holds on to. We are proud of our place name. It gives us our identity.
The English translation, although it's spelled like Matthew, it's still pronounced Máithtéithe. And I've just noted it's a place steeped in both story and in history. It's a great old story. It's a bit fanciful in parts, I know, but you know, given that penal times were so cruel, and then there was this huge release with Catholic emancipation, and people were free, they were sprung, they were released to practice as they wanted to. So, Máithtéithe, the plain of the flight, or the plain of fleeing. Yeah, or even the night of the great escape. I'll buy it.
My journey tracking the path of place names officer John O'Donovan has me in County Carlow.
Well, is it Derry or Londonderry? Dingle or Dangany Cooch? So many of our place names are quite contentious. I mean, should we use the original Gaelic form or perhaps the English translation? Well, I'm taking the train to a town that provides us with another brilliant example.
Winnebjug or Bagnall's Town. Confusion reigns. No one seems to know which is the right name for the County Carlow town. For generations, the town was known as Bagnall's Town, but about 40 years ago, the name Winnebjug began to creep in, and the whole affair has become more and more complex ever since. What do the people of the town think of this important issue? The Kilkenny people announces that a special investigation will be carried out next week. The people of the town will be asked to give their views, and the results will be published in the Kilkenny People.
That vote, held by the Kilkenny people in 1968, had the following results. 63% voted for Bagnall's Town, 21% for Winnebjug, and 16% didn't care either way. So, what do locals think today? I'm holding my own straw poll in the centre of town. We have three cards. If you think it should be Winnebjug, then the green one goes in the box. White, if you don't mind either way. And for Bagnall's Town, it's the gold card. Get it? Green, white and gold.
I would prefer Bagnallstown.
I say the Irish near the Brook. I say that, wouldn't
you? Prefer Muirfield, you would?
I'm torn.
You're torn.
Bagnallstown.
But Bagnallstown, are you?
Yeah.
Would you vote in the box there, so? Yeah.
While the voting takes place, I nip across the well-designed town to our rather grand local library.
Welcome to our town.
Where I meet Aidan Coburn, PRO of the local GAA club. He's going to tell me a little more about this town and the twin names.
The land was property of the Bagnall family, and Walter Bagnall II came up with the idea of building a town here on part of the area of Muinneog. And his plan was, he envisaged, was to build a town on the style of Versailles in France.
Did he christen it Bagnallstown, or...?
No, his intention was to call it Versailles.
Ah, come on.
Oh, yes, no, absolutely. But the local people, maybe out of deference to the lord of the manor, felt it should be called Bagnallstown.
That's remarkable. Yeah, and what about the Muinneog part, then?
That's a Gaelic thing,
mm-hmm.
a Gaelic name. That translates as small wooded area or small shrubbery.
And there's something beautiful about that, isn't there? I mean, that describes... the landscape,
as
it has been for millennia, whereas Bagnallstown was only one family's influence. What's the trend at the moment?
I've been involved with the sports here, and actually in the local GA, we've Muinneog, CLG, Stroke, Bagnallstown, Gaels.
There's no such ambiguity at Bagnallstown Cricket Club. Founded in 1846, it claims to be one of the oldest cricket clubs in the country. It was started by the workers and management of Brown and Crosswaith Milling Enterprises, a fact acknowledged by the Miller's Wheel that still stands proudly outside the club pavilion.
John, I'd like to present you with a cap with our emblem on it. It's a grinding stone from the mill.
Jim Brown is a stalwart of Carlow cricket.
I mean, it's not a huge county. How prolific was cricket here at its highest, would you say?
Oh, very prolific. You're talking about 15 teams, I'd say, in County Carlow.
15 clubs?
Yes.
In Carlow?
Yes. We had a competition here between all the pubs in the town.
Yeah.
And we allowed two cricket players to play in each pub team.
Yeah.
And the hurlers couldn't be beaten. We couldn't get the ball to hit the wicket when the hurlers were in.
Astonishingly, cricket was the most popular field game in Ireland by the 1850s. But the foundation of the GAA in 1884 and its designation of cricket as a foreign sport in 1901 led to its dramatic decline. Matt Baker is the current chairperson, and he has seen a resurgence at the club in recent years.
At its worst, like say, what kind of numbers were you down to?
We were down to about 5 years ago. We nearly dropped to one team.
That's 11,
yeah. So we'd have had about 16, 17 players. And we had a proper discussion about whether we dropped to one team. But we decided to cling on. And 2 years later, we had enough for a third team.
You've three teams now?
Three teams now,
Yeah, I didn't even ask, but I was threatened. Someone said to me, we're going to give you a go at this.
we'll do. We'll get you out there soon and get bowling at you.
In any other sport I've played now before, I've been full back. Can I be full back in this, no?
Full back, no.
There's no full back,
there's no full back in this.
Can I be goalkeeper?
There's no goalkeeper either.
Okay, I'm going to learn something new, sir. This is a practice one, is it? Four. Thanks a million. Oh, Jesus. And so to the results of the Carlow jury. As it turns out, the results are in. And in under half an hour, we took in a total of 40 votes. And this is exactly how it came out. There were 16 people favoured Muinneog, but there was a whopping 23 people favoured Bagnallstown. And there was just one white slip, meaning there was only one person that we met who didn't really care. That, to me, is the most significant one, because it just goes to show that people actually care. And the vibe I got from people in town was, call it Bagnallstown, call it Muinneog. We kind of find it cool to have two names for our town. I think I'll be back. For the cricket, definitely. All over Ireland, the word clan pops up on our place names. It comes from the Irish word cluan, meaning meadow. So you've got Clontarf, Cluan Tarov, the meadow of the bull. Then there's Clondalkin, Cluan Dalkin, Dalkin's meadow. Keep out. And today, I'm in Clonmel. Cluan Mala, the meadow of the honey.
These days, Clonmel is associated with cider and apples, of course. But these apple blossoms don't pollinate themselves. Where there's blossoms, there's bees. And where there's bees, there's beekeepers.
Today we need to check that there's enough stores in all of those hives.
The South Tipperary Beekeeping Association runs classes each Tuesday night for aspiring beekeepers, so I thought I'd give it a go.
Myself and John and...
Local beekeeper Erica Reeves is taking tonight's class.
This is the native Irish honeybee, the black bee, and they are brilliant for Ireland's weather, Ireland's damp weather, because they store a lot and they prepare a lot for awful days that, you know, where the rain is coming down.
So how many bees per hive, approx?
Approximately, at the height of the summer, I suppose you could expect about 40,000. Can you feel heat off it?
I do, actually. I feel warmth, yeah.
Yeah. We might be lucky and see the queen, but there is a lot of heat off it. There she is. There's the queen.
Oh, I see her. Whoa!
So she's marked.
And what's that green spot?
The green is so that you can find her a bit easier. And it makes manipulations in the hive so much easier.
They are peculiar little creatures, aren't they, bees?
Yes, they do have one quirk where you can only move the hive either 3 feet or 3 miles. If you move it only 1 foot to the left, let's say, they'll return to the 1 foot to the right. Or if I were to only move that hive a mile away, they will return back to the original position.
So I have to
move it 3 miles away.
Right, so the little bee's internal GPS says it recognises 3 feet or three miles, but anything else, it gets a bit confused.
Very confused, and just goes back home.
Beekeeping is a competitive pastime, believe it or not, and South Tipperary beekeepers are the Real Madrid of beekeeping. They've won countless cups and medals, including the World Cup. And tonight, I've picked up a prize myself, the coveted jar of Creedon's Atlas Honey. From Clún Mála.
Well, this has literally been a sweet day here in the rolling pastures of Tipperary. And I think our ancestors did very well when they named this place Clún Mála, the meadow of the honey. And it's funny how the little humble Irish bee has worked its way not just into our place names, but into the hearts of Irish beekeepers since monastic times and beyond. But for now, in answer to life's eternal question, to be or not to be, it's to be, most definitely. To be.
Last night as I lay dreaming of pleasant days gone by.
I'm in Spancil Hill, not the day before the fair, as the song goes, but on the day itself. It's a place name that is ingrained in the psyche of Ireland. Probably because of the song. But for the most part, it's the place name that has me here. For the most part. Tomás Machanumara is an oral historian from County Clare.
This actually is Spancil Hill that we're standing on, is it?
This is Spancil Hill, and, you know, it has a significance attaching it to the fair that's here below us.
So what's the original name for the place?
It's Cnoc Uair Cóil. If we break that down, right, and if I ask you to break it down, we say take Cnoc, we know it's
okay, hill.
So if we say Uair or Fuair.
Cold or fresh or...
Correct. And Cóil.
Is a forest, yeah.
A forest or a wood. So if we put that together, it's the cold wood hill.
Right.
Now, most people have interpreted it as Spancil Hill, because Uair Cóil is the Irish for Spancil.
Oh. So it's a very similar sounding word.
It is, and very naturally, it has been connected over the years, and over the centuries, in fact, with the fair that's happening here below us.
So a spancil, as I remember, was like a figure eight for a cow's hind legs to stop them lashing when you're milking them.
Correct.
But they use it for horses too.
They use it for horses as well.
But because that Uair Cóil sounds so like the word Uair Cóil, meaning spancil, people put one and one together and got two. Horse fair, Uair Cóil, it's got to be spancil rather than... White wood, is that it?
Exactly right.
Five and a half.
One.
That is.
Five and a half.
Five and a half.
One.
Fair days in Ireland have had a reputation in the past for wild behaviour.
Are you breaking my word?
Are you breaking it?
That's the price.
It's a part of our heritage that is in danger of disappearing under a blanket of health and safety and insurance premiums. But for now, the fair is in full swing.
Yes, you'll get no drink if I meet you tonight. Whatever goes your men home is hard.
It's all kid.
I'm meeting an old friend of mine who's no stranger to horse fairs or hoolies, actor and comedian John Kenny.
That was my first time in Spancil Hill.
Is it?
It is.
Will
it
you
is,
roll up and have a look?
Yeah, sure, let's do that.
But I know
yeah.
horses were always
there. Get that whip there. Everybody else went into the pack. Everybody else went into the pack, quick. Off to the stubborn tab, everybody else went in. Right.
By chance, we meet Mary McCarthy, the lady who taught John how to ride a horse a long time ago.
We get you back in the saddle.
Well, he's horse mad.
She's here to buy a particular type of horse. Bomb-proof.
Every fella has a horse that's bomb-proof.
Oh, then the horse won't get excited, is it?
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
That's the term they use, is it? So if I walk up to someone and say, is she bomb-proof? He'll know
yeah.
what I mean.
Yeah, he'll know exactly. Yeah. You're getting the lingo now.
I'm getting it because he
wouldn't meet. Give me more tips now before he goes down the fair now.
Trying to get him to spit right in the hand. He can't be spitting. He's a townie. He doesn't know how to
spit. Yeah. I haven't got it.
You've practised that there now and get it right.
And you've so you'll be spitting on each other all day.
You could be spitting. You could be. Here, we'll go out and see what we're doing.
Come on, we'll have a look, yeah. So we're looking for something bomb-proof. Bomb-proof. And loads of this, is it?
Yeah, so loads of spitting, yeah.
Your mum's standing. I have a few top whips in from Arrowbay.
Paddy Hassett is a member of Friends of the Fair, the group that saved the annual event back in the 1980s when it seemed in terminal decline.
Tis in the records anyway that King Charles II gave a charter to hold a fair in Spencer Hill. And 1621, so it would be 400 years in a couple of years' time. It was very much in decline in the 80s and became a bit dangerous because there was no organisation and there was crime and that. And so we found a crowd of us came together, we called ourselves Friends of the Fair. Mm-hmm. And we had, this ring is here for now, we're showing classes, like it's an agricultural show. Yeah. It has been going
very tidy there. And I suppose the song and the fair has actually put Spencer Hill, which is a tiny place, it's put it firmly on the map and it's kept it on the map.
Yeah, there was a man called Considine, his relatives are over there in Catalans.
Yeah.
He was dying in California when he wrote the poem, the song, and he sent it home. Robbie McMahon heard some old woman singing it and he took the words with
it. But it was almost forgotten, I'd say, like by my generation, until this man came along and he actually stuck that reggae beat into it. You have to sing it, John.
I thought I might as well now that I'm here for the first time.
You have to.
I'll have to.
The business of the fair is going on all around us. Our friend Mary is keen to get John up on a gelding that has caught her eye.
Good man, Johnny. Bring back two burgers and a bag of oats.
With the OK from John and a bit of a haggle, Mary has sealed the deal with a handshake.
Congratulations, Mary.
Yeah, well done.
Brilliant bike. Bomb-proof.
Jump.
And now it's time for John to sing for his supper.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, I paid a flying visit to my personally love. She's as fair as an old lily man. Oh, yeah. She's as gentle as the dove. Well, she threw her arms around me, saying, Johnny, I love you still. Oh, she was the ranger's daughter, not the farmer's daughter, that's ranger's daughter, it's different words. And the bride of Spencer Hill. Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
There you go, Spencer Hill. It's amazing what a place name will do. My curiosity about the name and the song brought me in here. I met up with old friends. I got a lot of it from the horse's mouth, the story of Spencer Hill, the original translations, and there are a couple of variations on that, all of them equally valid. I had a great day, though. Great day.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah,
yeah. I'm on the Dingle Peninsula, walking in the footsteps of Irish place names officer John O'Donovan. It's an area that has attracted tourists for decades, all the more when it came to international prominence following the filming here of Hollywood blockbuster Ryan's Daughter back in 1970. And now there's another wave of film tourists arriving. Star Wars fans, celebrating the filming of The Last Jedi here in 2017. There's even an annual festival called May the Fourth Be With You. That's held in Ballyferriter on the May weekend. I'm here to meet RTE TG Cahir reporter Sean McAtihi, a native of the area.
This is
the townland of Ballinartarig, and the parish is known as Próisne Teirg, the parish of Ferrater.
And first was Ryan's daughter, now it is all Star Wars with you.
That's right. Ballyferrater, the home of Star Wars, they say. But the Ferraters were here long before any Luke Skywalker came here.
And they have their biggest story to tell us.
They have, and they have their own warriors as well.
Oh, go away.
Yeah, they have. We'll head down to Count Shebaile.
Right. So this is all superheroes and swords and shields and fighting and everything?
It is. There's a lot of history and a lot of Shanachas, as we say, about the place.
Right.
But first, I'm keen to see where the Star Wars team built their set, a replica of the monastic beehives on Skelly Vihil. It's on private land, and Sean has arranged permission for us to be up here.
They built the set just over here, the monastery, the replica of Skellig. Yes. Just over there where the sheep are, it's called Bíonn Hir na Nuan, the grassy slope of the lambs. They selected it because it looks so similar to Skellig Vihil. Mm-hmm. You know, it's got that dark, craggy rock feel to it. There were a lot of restrictions on Skellig because of the archaeology and so on, so they had a bit more freedom and they weren't relying on the weather conditions as much here, you know.
Yes. And long before Star Wars came to town, I presume you were running wild here as a young fellow, were you around?
Yeah, we used to love coming up here, you know, because you have the cliffs and you have pathways, grassy pathways down through the cliffs there and back up, and we'd be sword fighting and cowboys and Indians. And so there's another spot I can show to you if you want. Gaoilín Ifrin, we call it.
Go on and show me. Where is it? Gaoilín an Ifrin.
Gaoilín Ifrin. It means the throat of hell.
The throat of hell.
So it's a straight drop.
Right, that's encouraging.
700 feet. We used to love coming up here firing stones down because you hear banging all the ways down. But there was a man down in the village there, we used to call him Clug.
Yes, but he
told us that every seventh stone you throw off here into Gaoilín Ifrin hits the devil on the head.
So you had a job to do, yeah?
Yeah. So it's a lovely sound. Like, we'll see if the cart throws any good.
Cart will be great. Watch this now.
Hit the devil in the head.
You know. Take that! Hold on.
You might hear him shout.
And I'd forgotten how much fun you could have with a stone.
We make our way out to Dúnan Air Teirg. Sean has spent a lot of time gathering the names of the townlands in the area from the older people in the parish. But here, it's not just the townlands that have names. Every rock and crag has its own identity.
The old people like Seamus Onion in the village here in Clug, they'd have given me a lot of the names along here. This is Dúnan Air Teirg, the fort of Ferrater, and Cána Dúna, the point of the fort. Then you move along over here to Unvejrach. That means the bitch, very high, dangerous cliff. You have a little patch there in the cliff, a little square, it's called Unanóg, the window. Outside it then, you've got the Bloch Beag, the narrow gap, and then Unfiach, that's that big, beautiful, triangular rock.
And that's what?
Unfiach is the raven.
Right.
And outside Unfiach then, you have Máthaidhnigh, the mother of the raven, protecting the big baby inside her, if you like.
Beautiful.
And in between them, then you have a small little submerged rock, its head
I
is just jutting
there,
up.
Yeah.
That's called Fochas na Narragán, the submerged rock of the sea bream. There was a time, I suppose, when those names were essential and relevant, extremely relevant, that your safety often relied on them. You needed to know. You didn't have GPS or radar or anything like that fishing out there, and you needed to know where the submerged rocks were. You needed to know where the good fishing grounds were.
Right.
And the way that was done and the way the information was passed along from generation to generation was through the names.
Star Wars might be a story of heroes and warriors, but the story of Count Shebaile is a tale of romance and tragedy.
It's Cuislán Fiarais, named after, I suppose, the most famous of the Ferraters, Piarais Ferrater.
Piarais Ferrater, name
yeah,
is what's it?
That's right. A poet, a warrior, a chieftain. And he was a bit of a ladies' man as well. He wrote a lot of love poetry and that. And he's a real, I suppose, folk hero.
And then, of course, there's Cheann Shebaile. Now, Cheann is a head or a headland, I presume. Who is Shebaile?
Well, according to the old story, Shebaile was the daughter of a Galway chieftain. and Pyrrhus had sailed up into Galway in his ship, and he'd invited the chieftain, the Galway chieftain, aboard. He was a Lynch, O'Leanchig, and he had brought his beautiful daughter, Siobhail, along with him. And there was entertainment and food and drink on board, but Pyrrhus laid his eye on Siobhail, and Siobhail took a shine to Pyrrhus as well. So Pyrrhus decided to ply the father with drink and knock him out, essentially. And he put him back down onto the small boat and sent him ashore. And then he gave the order, raise the sails and let us head victorious to Cuanachil, which is the name of the harbour here. A few weeks later, then, there was a big battle happening out here in the fields, and here you have the cave.
Oh, I can see the cave there, yeah.
We call that Paula Chislán. So he decided to send Siobhail along with his own sister, Urla, in there for safekeeping
while
the battle went on. But unfortunately, the battle continued much longer than anticipated. And by the time Pyrrhus returned to Paula Chislán, the tide had filled and the women had drowned. So it's, according to the story, then Count Siobhail was named after poor Siobhail. But I suppose for us, you know, Pyrrhus Fortier was our hero growing up, and he's been the hero of generations before us. You know, we had our own Luke Skywalker long before Star Wars came into town. And I'd like to think that Pyrrhus's memory and what he achieved and the legacy he left would outlive anything Disney or any other crowd could bring into a place like this.
You know, it's wonderful to think that John O'Donovan walked this very land almost 200 years ago, gathering the place names all around West Kerry. But what I find even more encouraging is the work that Sean Machatihic and people like him are doing, speaking to elderly people and gathering and memorising the names of not only the town lands, but the fields, the rocks, and every feature on the landscape. And that landscape really speaks. Cheann Siobhail. I mean, some of the tales I heard today and some of the mythology, it really brings home Sean's point that whatever about Star Wars, we've got a few epic tales to tell ourselves. And I think they blow Star Wars out of the water. Throughout this journey, I've been following in the steps of John O'Donovan, place names officer for Ireland in the 1830s. But what of the man himself? Where did he come from? And what was it that motivated him to travel Ireland, cracking the codes of the place names of every townland in the country? I'm meeting the modern-day John O'Donovan, Páraic O'Carroll. He's chief place names officer at the Department of Culture, Heritage and the Gaeltacht. And we're in Atatí Mór, where John O'Donovan was born.
Atatí Mór, it's a beautiful sound to it, isn't it?
Yeah, it comes from the Irish Atatí Mór, and that means the site of the big house. And by the way, this is supposed to be the site of Atatí Mór, of the big house.
It's found out here.
Yeah, according to an article that was written by Professor Michael Herity, this was it here, actually.
It's almost like a pilgrimage for me, really, after, you know, as I'm closing in on the final legs of my journey to arrive at his place. Was this the actual house where he grew up?
No, but we're not too far away, and I'm going to show you now where his birthplace.
Waiting for us is Jim Walsh, former headmaster of the National School in nearby Slieve Roo. He's also an authority on John O'Donovan's life and work.
Jim, this is John here.
Delighted to meet you at long last.
Very welcome, Jim. This is where the family grew up, John's family, and John lived in this area down here with his parents. Some while afterwards, when they became a bit prosperous, he decided it would be better to have the residence up here. 1816 was a disastrous summer for farmers. Mm-hmm. It was the year of no summer, it was called the year of no summer. They couldn't pay the rent, and lo and behold, they had to exit here. And leave the new house behind them. They leased a smaller holding up in a place called Bernayarig, Red Gap. Almost in the adjoining field was his uncle, who was a miller. He took John under his wing. And in fact, John learned from Pat all the local lore and names of fields and names of animals and birds.
So you think it was those hours spent with his uncle, Pat the Miller, that really acted as the catalyst?
Stimulator, yes. Yeah. Yes, absolutely.
Budget cuts at the time meant that O'Donovan never got to finish his place names work. He was called to the bar in 1847 and wrote extensively until his death in December 1861. As the current place names officer, Porrick has big and well-worn boots to step into. However, if O'Donovan mapped the country back in the 1830s, what does the place names office do today?
We're trying to establish the authoritative Irish names of all the place names, you know. Mm. We have a great database called Loganim. We have over 80,000 now Gaelic names, and we have the Irish forms of them established. It often strikes me, for instance, when people are building new estates, for instance, if it's on a hillside, there are all these words in Irish that are used for a hillside. You have Lerig, Lacca, and so on.
Shliev,
Aidan. Yeah. And why not use those names, you know?
I presume I'm not alone in disliking names like Bel Air Heights and Shrewsbury Mews and all of those, because a lot of them are just, they're kind of out of nowhere, aren't they?
In the last great building era we had, you know, when the Celtic Tiger was in full bloom, you had these names like the Cedars, the Beeches, the Palms. And many of these, I think I'm correct in saying that they were very aspirational, to say the least. And the thing is, of course, it shouldn't be, in my view, it shouldn't be completely left in the remit of a builder, of a developer, to decide what a place is called. Since, I think, in 1960, there's a United Nations group of experts on place names. They are also encouraging people, you know, to have databases and to have names that are established by authoritative groups. We have that here. A lot of countries would be jealous of us. We've such a great setup here now, a fine database.
While we here in Ireland may have succumbed to the whims of the housing market when naming new housing estates, in the far reaches of outer space, rules already exist on how places are named.
Whoa. Francis, how are you?
I'm here to meet Francis McCarthy of Blackrock Castle Mobile Observatory.
Objects in the solar system and beyond the solar system are all under the remit of the International Astronomical Union, the IAU.
Are we members of that? We are.
Ireland are members of the IAU. And in the last 25 years, planets around other stars have been discovered. We call those exoplanets. So this year, the IAU have assigned each country an exoplanet of their own to name.
Does that mean we get to name a planet?
So Ireland gets to name a planet. So looking up in the sky, there's our plough.
Oh yeah, that's a handy reference point.
Right below the handle, there's your dogs.
Yeah.
And the planet we're getting to name goes around a star just above the right-hand dog.
And what are the rules for naming it?
Well, they're pretty straightforward. 16 letters or less. Pronounceable in some language. You can't call it after your pet.
Okay.
Not for a living person. And nothing that's going to be copyright issues.
You must have a favourite already, do you?
Well, it's up there with the dogs. I want to reflect a little bit of the Irish history and the Irish heritage. I like Satanta.
I like that. Satanta's beautiful. Yeah, you got me thinking now. I think I'm going to spend the night lying awake, looking up at the stars and trying to come up with a name for you.
And so, my journey in the footsteps of John O'Donovan and the great place name pioneers has taken me full circle, back to the place where my own love affair with place and place names began.
It's been a real voyage of discovery, and you know, every time we stopped and drilled into a place name, we released fairies and mythology, information about the place, love, loss, and landscape.
The people I met confirm my belief that not only do we Irish have a sense of place, we have a love of place. All who came before us have left their footprint on the land and their words sprinkled all over the map.
And of course, now it's our turn to name the places that we construct. And I sincerely hope our hand is guided by the landscape that surrounds us. And instead of going for the aspirational Bel Air Heights and the like, we might opt instead for something like Cnoc na Gaoithe or Knock na Gaoithe, which means the same thing anyway. And if you can see the barracks, well then call it Barrack View. So I think this is our opportunity to leave a message under a stone for those who come after us.
And you can catch John again on RT Radio 1 weeknights from 8 and next tonight, Home of the Year, followed by Fair City, where eager for a quick sale, Hayley puts pressure on Mondo to buy a share in her company.
If you'd like to learn more about Irish place names, then go to loganim.ie.